don't tell the bishop, this is not for the bishop's ears. So basically I set the food banks up exactly the same as when we're dealing drugs. You get the product, it goes to a central location, it gets bagged up, then I pick it up and I take it out and distribute it. So it's called transferable skills and it works really well. How you going on with kids? Alright. Nightmares?
Yeah.
It's me again.
Thank you.
Oh, it's off. Chocolate things for kids.
Oh, thank
all
you.
Alright. That's for missus, she'll love you again. Alright.
Thank you.
Alright, pal.
Alright.
You take care, alright. See you later. I don't know, kind of really and truthfully, exactly what the pandemic's done in its fullness. I don't, but what I do know is I'm definitely seeing more poverty. Much, much, much more. More than I've ever seen before, anyway. You know, people that genuinely struggling to get the money together for the food week in, week out. And the amount of houses that I go to now that they don't have gas and electric on, I've never seen not like it. Yes.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, have a Snickers.
Will you give
Gary
some food?
Yeah, of course I will. Have you not got all gas?
No. Mick helped me out as well.
Here, have an orange.
Mick's helped me out quite a lot. Lent me money to get to work when I was struggling. Yeah. Which I really appreciate.
Poverty, innit? It's North West, it's Burnley for you, isn't it? Everyone's in the same boat, aren't they?
Yeah, that's it, man.
Yeah. If it weren't for this guy and what he's doing, then...
I were actually sanitising 8 hours a day, you know, because of COVID. And the only reason I got laid off from there were... I had a bit of cold one day and I got in work and they told me to have COVID test. Can't work till you've got results. Obviously, they come back negative, but by the time my results and everything had come back. My partner had deleted text off his phone, so I had to go for another one. So I had to have two. And they said, your job's gone. It's been talked by someone else.
We have a good friend in common, didn't we? That it's kind of, he took his own life.
Yep.
There's a lot of our friends have, so. Gas probably won't mind me saying, it'd be waiting, you know, for detoxes and rehabilitation and stuff like that. You might as well be on Mars, because you're waiting forever, aren't you? You
can't. At least 3 months.
Yeah, and so this is because of the pandemic. Before, it would have all been easier. Not easy, but it would have been easier. I've noticed that you've really, really struggled and gone down in this.
I have, yeah.
It's been tough on you.
Been having to stay at different friends' house for a while now, because my mum's at her final stage lung disease and she can't even let me round to her house or anything in case I pass something on to her, so it's taking its toll.
Yeah.
So the support network I had, I haven't got anymore.
Yeah.
So...
We wow. keep going, brother, don't we?
Of course we do. Well, was that,
keep
haven't
going,
we?
Yeah. You know, poverty is never about money. It's about lack of access to the same things as everybody else, whether that be education, whether that be benefits, whether that be technology. And wherever that's lacking, you'll find the poor. And wherever the poor are, that's kind of where we want to be. Some gloves for him, I haven't got any. Let's get something to eat now, get a brew. There you go. Sit down in there. So yeah. So what have you relapsed on?
Wyatt.
Wyatt.
Sick of fucking up.
So, come here, man. Come here. Come here. So I've just been with this kid. He's been in an out of care system all his life. I know his mum. His mum's in rehab and she's doing really well. He's messed up, he's in pieces, he's in bits. He don't know what to do, he's suicidal. A boy. So it is emotional sometimes. People like him are getting more and more and more and more. It's really easy to talk about figures and numbers and COVID and masks and everything else. But when you talk about what's really happening, it's more and more uncomfortable when you see it in real daylight and real terms. And it should be uncomfortable. When I die, I want to have made a difference. That's it. In a positive way. Because the first half of my life, I made a difference in a negative way. So, and that's all I'm interested in. And my faith allows me to do it. I couldn't do any of this without the faith that I have and the belief. Because the belief's not in myself. And that seems to be what works for me anyway. When I took a drug, I felt confident. I felt different. I was somebody else. So I wanted to live in a fantasy world to take me away from who I was. And it did, but it was worse. It got worse. I've been through sexual abuse. I've been through much, much trauma. I've been homeless. I've been rich. I've been very, very poor. I've committed a lot of crime. I've been a victim and I've created victims. I've been married. I've been divorced. I've seen partners die. I've been loved and I've been unlovable. And all these things allow me to be what I am now, and they allow me to serve the people I serve and give people hope and build a community that's better than the one that they were in before. Closing it. It's closing it as well. It says teenage girl, but you're thin at the moment.
Oh, yes.
I died twice in October. I died on my birthday. And then the next day, I died again. And somebody had to kick the door in. Injection again, brought me down. Third day, I tried to kill myself. And then I woke up on the fourth day. I thought, well, God's obviously got a purpose for me. I'm obviously meant to be here. And then my daughter turned up and she was like, And she went, you need help. I said, I know I need help. I know it's time now. Yeah. You know, I mean, if not, I know I'm going to be in a box.
All gone. All gone, I'm afraid. So these guys that you've just seen, most of them obviously are still using. So they come to our recovery groups, which we've had to shut down because of the COVID. It's almost put their lives on hold till they can go back in there and start addressing their addictions again and looking at life in a different way. So. I've seen many, many young men and young women take their own life over the past months. People have just lost hope. They don't know which kind of way to turn. And for me, the balance between COVID and mental health hasn't been fully assessed. But after COVID, you'll see a scary statistic will be there. It's a town that wants to pull together, but it's a town that's been pulled apart. Addiction is a big part of what we do because it's a big part of what keeps people in poverty. This is pointless if somebody's addicted and all you're doing is throwing food at them. So we offer an alternative. So we have a recovery program and we meet regularly and we pull people into that recovery and it helps to break poverty.
Just amazing, like the change in just 2 years. But I was poor internally once, spiritually broken. You know, and I'm not today, thankfully, to God and to recovery and to these meetings. You know, but I can go out there and I can help the people who are in that position.
You know, I was always so judgmental towards others, even though I was the heroin addict. You know, like scurrying around streets with my hood up, hoping I didn't bump into anyone, and stealing and doing whatever it took to get my drugs. And you know, I'm not gonna lie, I still get thoughts. I still look at some people and think, oh, he looks bad news, you know. But I don't act on it today. So I will throw that thought aside and just showing unconditional love, regardless.
I'm Mick, I'm an addict. Mick. Spent my whole life running to drugs, running here, there and everywhere, and I never hung around long enough. You know, if there were any hurt, I were gone. You know, I just cause a bit more pain somewhere else. It's good to be here, and it's good to know that I'm lost. I struggle, just like everybody else. Get kettle on. It's not all doom and gloom, you know. The guys that serve with me are the people that was like me, the worst of the worst. I'm very, very much lost. And now they're doing amazing things to change the society of the world that they live in. Yeah, there's something about the wanting to become selfless sort of keeps them free.
What would you like?
Right,
okay. I'm actually going through an ordination process with Pastor Mick. When he feels that I am ready, I'm going to take over Church on the Street Ministries in Barnoldswick. So I will be Pastor Sarah here. and we're just going to really carry on doing the work that we're doing, you know, because in 9 months we've set up a church, a food bank, a recovery meeting and a charity shop.
Our end goal in Barnoldswick is to have a residential rehabilitation centre. You know, like obviously we're fully connected with people on the streets who have addiction issues and whatnot, and people like us who was not so long ago seen as being the scum and the lowest of the law, you know, we can help them further themselves in life, you know, and get well and stuff the way we did.
Just trying to show as much love and support and care as we can, really.
It's spreading. So yeah, it's a beautiful thing what's happening.
It is.
You know, it really is.
Strawberry. You can eat some, don't you? Well, like, sweet is strawberry one.
Yeah.
I love this work because it shows me what I am. It shows all my flaws. It shows where I fail. But it shows the compassion that I have that I never had before. You know, I've robbed off my own children. And I've got this thing now inside me that's, it's just like joy all the time. It don't go away. It's like, wow. Better than any drug I've ever had. And I've had them all, you know. I'm high on Jesus.